All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. This is a North Texas Teen Book Festival panel. This is called Fantastical Tales. We are so excited that you're here with us and so grateful that you're joining us. My name is Kristen Dickson. I'm the picture book author of Fiona Builds a Fairy House, which is out with McMillan next year. And I also run Storytime Book Club on Instagram, which covers everything from picture books, early chapter books, as well as middle grade books. So I am just so honored to be in the same room, if you will, as all of these powerhouse middle grade fantasy authors. We're all just so excited to be here today. So before we get started with our questions, I wanted to just go over a couple housekeeping items. First, I wanted to do two shout outs. One is to the city of Irving for being our host city. And then another just to everybody that has worked so hard to bring NTTBF to a virtual festival this year. It's certainly new for everyone. And we're just so grateful that you're joining us today. And so grateful to everybody that, like I said, worked so hard to pull it off. It's just, it's really, really great. And then three other things, sort of to-dos. The first one is to be sure to check out the hashtag. It is hashtag NTTBFest for, you know, everything relating to the festival this year. And then also make sure to check out bookshop.org. There is a really awesome storefront that has been built out for the festival and for all of the authors and their books specifically. So definitely go shop there, not only for this panel, but for all of the other panels. And then speaking of all of the other panels, be sure to check out all the other panels, all the other keynotes. That's the one nice thing, not the one nice thing, a nice thing about this being virtual that you don't have to pick and choose. You don't have to, you know, go to one instead of the other. You can actually, you can watch everything this year. So, okay, with that, we are going to go ahead and get started. So what we're going to do is I'm going to have each author introduce themselves and their most recent books, and then a fun fact, you know, so something that people might not know about you. Maybe you've had a crazy job in the past. Maybe you have a fun hobby. Maybe you have a slew of crazy cats with fun names. Maybe you love donuts with all the passion in the world. You know, just something fun that you can share. So Lisa, do you wanna get us started?
Sure. Hi everybody, I'm Lisa McMann, and my 26th book just came out. It is The Unwanted Quest, Dragon Fury. It's the last book in this 14 book series. And wow, what a long time coming. The first one came out in 2011. So this has been part of my life for so many years, and it was such a joy to write this final book in the series and for it to come out so that everyone can read it now. And for those of you who, you know, like to wait until the entire series is out before you start reading, now's your time, time to go. Fun fact about me, some people might not know that my daughter plays Nancy Drew on the CW show by the same name. So there's a fun fact.
Awesome. Well, I love it.
How are you supposed to top that? Like, that's just like, that's almost.
She should have went last.
Yeah. My daughter's Nancy Drew. Great.
Fine. Mystery solved. Done.
You guys have. Come on. Bring it.
All right, Shannon, you want to go next?
Oh, I get to follow that. Okay, great. Wonderful. Okay, so hi, I'm Shannon Messenger. I'm the author of the Keeper of the Lost Cities series, which is the story of Sophie Foster and the adventures of her and her many friends. My quick pitch for the series is sort of Lord of the Rings meets X-Men. It's kind of fantasy creatures with more of a superhero feel. The most recent book in the series is kind of a unique one. It's called Unlocked, and it's actually 8.5 in the series because it is part next section of the story, part series guide to kind of help everyone stay caught up, because any of you who've looked at this series, you know they're quite long. I think we're up to like 6,000 or 7,000 pages in the series. And so it's a lot to keep track of. So we put this all together so that it would be a way of sort of keeping track of all the little clues that I've peppered through and giving you all kinds of new little things. It's all stuff that readers had asked me about and that I had never found a way to work into the books, that we kind of give it to you here and then the next part of the story as well. And then it will be followed by the next book in the series, you know, writing it as fast as I can, promise. As for fun facts, well, again, I'm friends with somebody whose daughter is Nancy Drew. So aside from that, my readers may already know this, but the Ella that Sophie sleeps with in these books is actually based on a real stuffed animal that I still sleep with. So yes, despite the fact that I am supposed to be an adult, I still sleep every night with a bright blue stuffed animal named Ella that is an elephant wearing a Hawaiian shirt, just like Sophie's. I seriously can't sleep without her. I don't know what to do with my arms. Like, how do people sleep without stuffed animals? It's a mystery to me. I've tried and it's just not comfortable. So if you're having trouble sleeping, I recommend finding a snuggle buddy of some sort of stuffed animal. They work wonders.
That's completely valid. All right, BB, you want to go next?
Sure. My name is BB Alston, author of Amari and the Night Brothers. That wasn't too bright. It's about a 12-year-old girl. She's from the Atlanta Projects. She's desperate to find her missing older brother who's been gone for about 6 months. And in order to get an answer, she kind of follows into this mysterious summer camp at the Bureau of Supernatural Affairs, where she learns that supernatural creatures from myths and legends are all real. But they don't take just anyone. So she has to compete against kids who've known about the supernatural world their whole lives for a spot. And more than just like myths and magic, it's really about just the young girl learning to kind of accept herself and kind of learn to believe in herself too. Fun fact. I was getting ready to kind of, I was on a med school track when the whole book thing happened. So I'm not sure how fun that is. I love red velvet cake. That's probably my favorite thing in the world. I'm not sure how fun that is either, but I guess that's what I'll go with.
Good. That's great. Yeah. So Kwame and Yoel, you guys collaborated on Last Gate of the Emperor. So Kwame, do you want to go first and just give a quick introduction and your fun fact?
Sure. My name is Kwame Mbalia. I am the author of the Tristan Strong series. And most recently with my co-author Yoel, author of The Last Gate of the Emperor. Da, 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 da. That's the theme song that I just made up. I didn't run it past you, Yoel, but I was hoping we could talk about it and work it in. Fun fact. I fell through a floating mat of dead vegetation in the forests of North Carolina. And had to, no one would come rescue me because they would also fall through as well. And I floated there for like 15 minutes, which is a long time to float and just think about existence and how much you really enjoy it. And to top it off, had to walk back soaking wet on railroad tracks because it was the only path through the forest that were covered with copperhead snakes. So that is when I decided that the outdoors was not for me.
Completely fair, yes. How old were you, Kwame?
I was in graduate school, so like, I was a grown dude, and I was like, you know what? Career change.
You're missing the part of how you ended up falling through.
That's not relevant. That is unimportant. It's just where my life hit a switch.
Yes. That's a really good origin story, like a superhero origin story right there.
Villain origin story.
Okay. I stand corrected. Okay, Yoel?
Yeah, and hi, everyone. Hi, NTTBF. So happy to be here. I'm the co-author of Last Gate of the Emperor. And this is a story that is going to be a really unique experience for our readers because it's set in Ethiopia, in a futuristic Ethiopia, but they will also get a chance to get a glimpse into the history of Ethiopia. So the past, it's the future and the past. And it's all through an amazing adventure with our young hero, Yared Hiwat, and his rival turned unlikely ally, the Ibis. And so they have great fun in this video game that's augmented reality. So there's all the fun stuff, very accessible to young readers, but also very educational. And I will give you one fun fact is that, as my title says, Prince Yoel, I'm a member of the royal family of Ethiopia. And I'm the great grandson of Emperor Haile Selassie, who was the last emperor of Ethiopia. And I had it as a fun fact because people do ask me if Prince is like my first name or if it's just like a cool title I like to add. But no, I'm a real life royalty.
So we are sandwiched between Nancy Drew and royalty. So Shannon, BB, we gotta figure something. We gotta collaborate on something.
We gotta step up our game here, guys.
throw us under the bus, why don't you?
I know, seriously. Good night, everybody.
That's it. It's a wrap. Thank you for coming to NTTBF.
All right, perfect. So we are going to kick things off with an audience question. And BB, I would love for you to answer this one for us. It's from Bridget at Edmond Memorial High School. And she says, you guys are all my idols. Who were the authors that you looked up to?
Oh man. There's so many, gosh, I always get this question. I always freeze up because there's so many. Recently I've been saying, Angie Thomas and Nick Stone, just because, I find those authors at such a time when I was really kind of struggling with how much myself to put in the book. And when I was younger, I was a really big Maya Angelou fan. My mom was really big into her. And so she kind of passed those poems on to me. And I found those to be so magnificent, so kind of opened my eyes to what poetry could be, so those would probably be the ones I would say, yeah, for mm-hmm. sure.
Does anybody else want to chime in?
Well, BB took my answer. I was going to say Angie and Nick, and since he said it, I can't say it. I would like to say that, so Lisa mentioned, since we're on the Nancy Drew topic, I read nearly every Nancy Drew and the Hardy Boys, mystery. I was big into mystery when I was a kid. And so I read Nancy Drew, I read the Hardy Boys, I read it when they collabed, which were always like mind-blowing, like, oh my God, like these characters are joining forces. One person who I read, and I probably wasn't supposed to read, but because it was a little older, but I love the mysteries, and his books just got announced that they would be turned into a series, the Easy Rollins series, is Walter Mosley and Devil in a Blue Dress. Again, it was a mystery, and it was a, I'm young, and we can spend a whole session talking about how I read books that I was probably not supposed to read, and not scarred, but I learned things probably earlier than I should have. But Devil in a Blue Dress, it was a mystery, it was Black history, it was just a fantastic novel. And that is still to this day, one of my favorite novels of all time. And I love, because, all right, this is Gum Baby, all right? No one knows this. I think this is the very first time I've said this anywhere, but Gum Baby is like Mouse in the Easy Rollins series. And if you know who Mouse is and you know the impact and how Mouse was always ready to get into a fight, always ready to defend his friends, you see how he and Gum Baby have a little bit of similarities in them.
I love it. Okay, we have another audience question. This one is for Shannon. Tatum from Pearson Middle School asks, Shannon, how do you manage 8.5 books worth of information without leaving out any important elements or forgetting things characters have done/said 5 books previously?
I wish I had some answer that, I could pretend that I'm really smart, but no, sadly, it's a combination of, I always have the PDFs of the other books open as I'm drafting and I'm constantly keyword searching things. And then this is where having a publisher is a wonderful, wonderful thing because I actually have a team. I got to a point after about book 6 where I got nervous about totally trusting myself. It was like, I think I remember this and I did some keyword searches, but I don't know. So I started just putting in parentheses like, someone double check this. And so I don't have just one copy editor. I have like multiple copy editors. I don't have just one editor. I have multiple editors. And we have a lot of eyes on the books trying to keep it all straight. I'm sure there's probably still little tiny things because, you know, sadly, authors never get enough sleep. So there's been a couple of things. Like there was one, I guess in book one, Sophie eats a piece of food that tastes like pizza. And then in book three, I had a sentence about how she couldn't find any foods that tasted like pizza. And, you know, so little things do sneak in. I think we corrected that one over time, but at least for the big stuff, I try to keep a running list of stuff that I still need to answer as I'm writing the next books and then do so much keyword searching. It's probably like half my writing day is spent looking things up just to verify that I'm remembering it correctly, because naive Shannon totally thought like, I'll remember everything. Oh, she was so cute and so clueless.
Okay, so the next question is for Lisa, who I think can probably identify with Shannon's plight. So Unwanted Quests is your fifth series, right? Including your YA series?
Let's see. So the Wake Trilogy, then we had the Visions Trilogy, and then Unwanted, and then Going Wild. Yeah, and the Quest, yeah.
So can you just...
one big series though.
Okay. So can you talk about your experience with writing Unwanted Quests and how it's been different from your series in the past, and just sort of your feelings around it ending?
Wow. So writing the Unwanted Quests, for those of you who don't know, the Unwanted is a 7-book series, and then the Unwanted Quest picks up in the same world with the same characters 10 years later. And it was interesting because I really wanted it to be different from the first series, and aging up the characters was really difficult for a few of them, thinking about what has happened to them in this 10 years, and how did that shape how they view the world today. But also it was so much fun to return to the world and to expand it a little bit, because now we're not just staying in the Seven Islands. We have moved on to a new part that was on a map in the first series that no one could find. And so that discovery happens early on in the Unwanted Quest series. But it was also kind of difficult to begin with two new main characters who were 2 years old in the first series, and now they are 12. And so that was difficult, but really fun to switch over to new sets of eyes as they, you know, explore this world for the first time. As far as how I feel about it being done, I feel really happy that it's done, but also I just kind of cry a little bit when I think about the ending and how I've had that in mind for so long, and something that I couldn't wait to get to. In fact, that I wrote the ending, I think I started the final book and I wrote the first couple of chapters, and then I was just like, I'm just going to write the end, because that's what I really wanted to do. I couldn't wait to get there. And so I wrote the last couple chapters, and then I filled in the rest of the book. And it was just really meaningful to me. It was bittersweet, hard to say goodbye. I never got tired of these characters. So that, you know, I think for 14 books worth, that's, you know, that was just a real gift.
Awesome. Okay, so this next question is for Yoel. So it's a two-parter. First, can you talk about your inspiration for Last Gate of the Emperor? And then also tell us what your favorite part was about collaborating with Kwame?
Sure. So The inspiration is I really wanted, and both Kwame and I wanted to portray a great adventure story in Africa so that readers can discover a new part of the world. And I'm from Ethiopia originally, obviously. And my inspiration was to kind of tell the story of my country through the lens of a young boy who kind of discovers his roots. And that's actually a personal story for me because I actually grew up as a prince in exile. So it, you know, in my formative years, I used to hear these stories and my family would tell me, but I didn't really, you know, I was separated from my home country. So it took a little bit of time to kind of rediscover my roots and the arc of the stories to kind of explain that. And it sounds like a very unique story, but it's also very relatable because I think all kids at that age are trying to discover who they are and reconnect with their roots and their story. And once they do, I feel like it's such an empowering feeling. The inspiration is also from real places and people in Ethiopia. So I really hope that it's going to spark curiosity for kids who are reading to discover even more after they've done the adventure with Yared and his bionic lioness to find out the real history of Ethiopia. And the best part was actually working with Kwame because I have to say, to answer the first question, I know it wasn't addressed to me, but Kwame is one of my idols. I love him as an author. He's just so fun. I loved Tristan Strong. The series is just so compelling. Actually inspired me also to want to write a book similar to that. And that's why I was so happy to collaborate with Kwame. And I think that he just has this very instinctive, fun, adventurous, and kind of spirit of like a child around that age, of the middle grade age, that I think is just such a pleasure and exciting and fun to work together. So I'm really grateful and I'm really excited for everybody to discover the book.
So my next question is for Kwame. Are you crying?
I'm touched. And
I had to let the world know.
Listen, that is absolutely that is so, so incredibly gracious of you and thank you. And I would just like to say, I would like to actually ask Bibi, what is your favorite thing about me?
I'm the same thing, man. He's just a cool dude, man.
Shannon, okay. I'll text you later about it.
Okay, so yeah, so you're inspiring me to change my next question a little bit. Okay, so it is for Kwame though. So what I was going to ask was, what were your favorite scenes to write in Last Gate of the Emperor? So we should say that, so the book's not out until May, right?
May 4th.
Okay. Yeah. So no spoilers.
No spoilers.
But could you tell us, were there chase scenes or, you know, action scenes or battle scenes or world building or something really funny that you loved? And then, sorry, follow up. What is your favorite thing about Yoel?
So I have two favorite. One is kind of generic and the other is specific and it's a spoiler. So, and I'm not going to give that one. I'll just kind of talk around it. The first, though, is I love video games. I love video games. The Last Gate of the Emperor has one of the best video games. You know, when we think about video games that I would love to play or that anybody would love to play, you know, it's the battle royales. You know, you think of Fortnite, you think of PUBG, you think of all of these different games that have really hit the scene strong. And are relevant right now. And I'm like, man, what would, you know, a battle royale, what would a futuristic battle royale look like, right? And so we have augmented reality, we have people choosing, you know, flying in different vehicles that they have, you know, custom modded, and that with the overlay of augmented reality can become wondrous different mechanisms, different flight vehicles. So just writing about video games is just, you know, exhilarating. It's fun. And to talk even more generic about my other favorite scene, I like to write scenes that I end up reading and crying, right? So like, I like writing really emotional, touching scenes. And there is one scene in the book where our main character gets to ask a question that he always wanted to ask, and he gets an answer, and the answer makes me cry. And I think everyone, you know, Yoel, you know, you probably know the scene, and I can't get more, Yoel knows what it is, but I can't get more specific than that. We can't get more specific than that because it would kind of give it away. But scenes, and I don't know if any of the authors, if you agree or not, but it's kind of similar to what Lisa was saying, where she couldn't wait to get, you know, to the end to write that ending, because that's what she was looking for, that closure, right? That moment of understanding that everything has kind of wrapped and tied together. When you get the answer that to a question that has been haunting you your whole life, right? Something that you've always wondered, something that you never thought you'd get the answer to, and you hear it, and it may not be the one that you were expecting, but it's the one that is validating and whole and completes you, that is really emotional to me. So those are the type of scenes I like to write. My favorite thing about Yoel, I have a list somewhere, and one of the girls might have taken it to use for scrap paper for math, because math these days is ridiculous. But Yoel and I share a passion for telling stories about Africa, right? The Africa that was, the Africa that is, that many people don't understand or kind of glom all together as just one, when there are so many disparate cultures, ethnicities, and just people, right? Beautiful people that people don't, you know, they have this one kind of doppelganger in mind, Africa and the African. But Yoel, like, he has this purpose to kind of dispel that notion, right? To show not only Ethiopia and all of its glory in the past, present, and what it will become if more people like Yoel are working towards it in the future, but all of Africa, you know, from the west to the southern tip to the northern to the east. Yoel just has that drive and passion, and that's why it's really an honor working with them. And I would think my father, who is, you know, my parents are what are called, you know, Pan-African, and believe in the unification of, you know, African peoples and descendants across the diaspora, from Brazil to Georgia to Jamaica to, you know, different parts of Africa itself. He passed in 2017. I think he would have loved to sit down with Yoel over a cup of coffee and just talk. And I think that is the biggest compliment that I could give about working with Yoel.
You guys are making me so excited to read this book.
Good. Audience, good, please pre-order. It comes out on May 4th.
Okay, so next question is for Bibi. Okay. So you have said in previous interviews that Amari was not your original main character, that you had written somebody else in mind, and, you know, sort of struggled with the story a little bit. So I was just wondering if you could talk about how you realized that this was Amari's story to tell, and if there were any additional themes that sort of came to mind once you started writing from her point of view.
Okay, so it actually did start as Amari.
Oh, it did? Okay.
Yeah, it did. And then what happened was I took it to my writing group. I was all excited. And they said, you know, you're never going to sell a kid's fantasy book with a black main character. And that's when I really kind of struggled, because I looked at the bookshelf and there just wasn't any, you know. And so that's when I kind of said, well, maybe I do need to change it. Maybe, you know, in order to get published, I have to make it, you know, kind of a typical, you know, a wisecracking kind of, you know, white boy that I was used to reading about. And so I did that for a while, and then I kind of realized that, you know, when I did that, I kind of lost the heart of the story, mm-hmm. kind of lost the story, the reason I wanted to tell the story to begin with. And so I went back to Amari and I said, you know, if it doesn't sell, then it just doesn't sell. And it was through that I kind of, you know, find out what I wanted to say with the book. And that's when I kind of realized that I was kind of telling my own story too, in a way, because, you know, I was that kid from, you know, the projects who didn't feel like he measured up to the kids from the more affluent side of town. And so, just in doing that, I was able to kind of tell my story, tell the story to people that, you know, around me in that neighborhood that, you know, we're all trying to get out and we're trying to make, you know, better of ourselves. And, but also, you know, in doing that, not, you know, kind of, Lamar starts the book off and she's kind of ashamed where she's from. And then by the time the book ends, she kind of learns to appreciate that. And that was my own journey. Kind of learned to appreciate where I came from, the people that, you know, I grew up with. And so it was really important to me. That was, meant a lot to me as far as, you know, not only story-wise, but also my own personal journey as well.
Awesome.
So glad you didn't listen to that writer.
I know.
So glad.
And I just started reading the book. And that first chapter just flew by. It's so good, everybody. Please buy this book.
Oh, thank you so much.
I'm about halfway through it. It's just like, okay, so we have one more question before lightning round, and it is for Shannon. It's from Bailey at Pearson Middle School. And Bailey wants to know, Shannon, how do you think the Keeper of the Lost Cities movie is going to turn out? In parentheses, I am totally fangirling right now.
Well, I mean, for one thing, you know, I like to kind of give the managing expectations thing, like just because we've sold to Disney and we have a director and a screenwriter attached and it's someone who's a name, you know, and all of that. Sadly, there's still like this huge ladder that we have to climb before. This is why, like, everyone who's emailing my poor assistant wanting to be in the movie, there's no casting calls. I, the author, by the way, will have no say in the cast at all. But, you know, it's funny because I held on to the movie rights. I mean, I just sold them and I'm on book 8.5 in the series. And there were deals that came along all throughout that process. And I think, given that I come from a Hollywood background, I graduated from the USC School of Cinematic Arts, I knew just enough about Hollywood to know, wow, Hollywood is where so many of my favorite books go to die. And so I really just, there's something about the process that just because movies are hundreds of millions of dollars, as the author, you're never going to get total control over everything. You're probably not even going to get a whole lot of control over anything. But I just kind of decided I was going to wait until I had a team that felt like they understood it. And so I turned down several things that people were just like, you turned that down? And I was just like, I didn't feel like they understood the books. And I didn't feel like we would get a good movie. So it's still a bit of a gamble, because, you know, obviously I'm not the one writing the script. That'll be up to, right now it's up to Ben Affleck and an amazing writer named Kate Gritman, who I've gotten to speak with both of them. And what I love is that they really, like, are fans of the series. They have actually read all the books, which I know seems like a given, but trust me, in Hollywood, there are a lot of times where movies are in development and, you know, the people working on them have not actually read the books. They've just read some sort of, like, summary that their assistant typed up for them. So to have a team where everyone has actually read the whole series and really seems to understand it and to understand what's important about it. When I spoke to Ben, he talked a lot about how his approach to adaptation is that obviously things have to change, but it's about capturing the essence. And so a lot of the questions that he asked me were trying to get to the heart of, like, what I was going for with each scene so that he could sort of make sure that if one of them had to change, that we got the same sort of feeling from whatever went into its place. So it feels like it's in very good hands. And that if we start continue climbing that ladder, that it will be something that comes out good. But really, I'm with all of you. I'm sitting here sort of nervously biting my and crossing my fingers and just sort of hoping that this turns into a great thing, because, you know, obviously it's kind of like my children. You know, I sort of feel like I sold my children to Disney. But, you know, it's not a bad place to sell your children. If you're gonna do it, send them to the Magic Kingdom, right?
You know, Shannon, you could have used that Ben Affleck line for your fun fact.
Yeah, that's true.
I could have, but, you know, I'm just sort of so many degrees away from Ben. You know, it's not like we're texting each other all the time. Like, yo, Ben, saw this. Like, not the case.
Well, we're all super happy for you.
Thank you. I'm excited. I really am. I mean, I was starting to get to a point where I was just like, I don't think I'm ever going to sell these movie rights. Cause I just, so many times it was like, I understand like these are great, talented people, but I don't know. It doesn't feel right. And this one just, it did. So we will see. I mean, obviously if it doesn't climb up the ladder, then rights revert back and we can possibly sell it to somebody else and try again. You never know, but at least this was a good place to try. So we'll see what happens. And I promise I'll keep everyone updated. It's just right now, Hollywood moves at the speed of sludge. So it's very like, hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait. And then all of a sudden it's like, things are going. So yeah, right now it's a holding pattern. I'm not keeping secrets from you. I just, you know, I'm still waiting anxiously for news as well.
Does anybody else have any other movie news that they want to share or anything else fun that people might not know?
Yeah, I wanted to add that, Shannon, I totally relate to what you're going through, because that's another fun fact I could have added, is that it is my debut as an author, but I'm also in film and TV and producing. And actually, I'm in LA now. I used to live in DC, moved here to do that. And everything you said, Shannon, is so true. You really have to find people you feel good working with, people you think are going to do the right thing with the story. And even if, like you said, you can't control all of the elements, it's important to have someone who has good judgment. So when you hand it over, it does feel like a baby or a child. You're like, okay, take care of my story that I'm giving you. I'm hoping to, between now and the end of the year, my wife and I, we started our own film production company to announce a couple of film in development. So stay tuned. I'll keep everybody posted as well.
So Shannon knows Ben Affleck and their besties. Yoel is a movie producer. Bibi, are you hiding something? No? Okay, so there's no fun fact that you could have pulled out that you didn't, and now you're going to produce it as a trump card.
You know, I did meet the guy who played Luke Cage in a Whole Foods one day. I know how exciting that is.
Is he really big and tall, like in real life?
He really is. He's enormous. I couldn't believe how big he was.
Unbelievable. I saw it. Am I the only honest one here? That was my most funnest fact. And you all are just holding aces up your sleeve. You know what? This is, I swear.
Hey, guys, is my picture frozen?
Yeah.
It's frozen in a good position.
Yeah.
It is. Yeah, it is. You look great.
Usually when mine freezes, I'm like.
Yeah, let me check.
There we go. There he is. Bibi, do you have anything that you would like to share?
What were we talking about? I think I lost it when I was doing my video thing for a second.
We're just talking about any media or movie news.
I think it's a lot like Shannon. The rights are sold, but you know, just there's a lot of, you know, hoops you still have to jump through. Still have to get greenlit, and then. So that's kind of where we are with it. So it's kind of the same thing. And you just can't kind of cross your fingers and hope everything works out, you know?
So Bibi, tell them who you sold it to.
We sold it to Mandeville Pictures and also Don Cheadle and then Marseille Martin's production company.
Nice.
I got to talk to Don Cheadle on the day Avengers came out. So that was pretty cool.
Oh, man.
That was pretty cool.
Yeah, there's a fun fact.
All right, are we ready for lightning rounds?
Please, let's get to the lightning round.
We have 9 minutes left. Can we do it?
We'll try.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'm gonna just call your names just for, you know, Zoom, nobody talking over each other. Okay, so favorite writing snack or beverage, Lisa.
Boring. Water.
Okay. Shannon?
Pepsi, sadly.
Okay, Kwame?
Cheez-Its.
Nice. Well?
I like to have some chai with Kinder Bueno. A little chocolate piece together. That's my fuel.
Okay. Bibi?
I like these little cashew bars right here. Oh, they're just the best.
Those are so good.
They're so good.
Okay. What do you like to write to? Do you like to write to music, silence, maybe an action blockbuster on in the background you've seen a million times? Lisa?
We usually have the TV on to some like YouTube nature picture, mm-hmm. or sometimes we watch the live panda cam, which is the best. Like, seriously, everyone should have the panda cam.
I would get no work done. I would just stare at the panda cam and be like, what? That was my work day? Okay.
Yeah, but silence other than that.
Okay. Shannon?
It varies depending if it's a scene where I'm having to do a lot of like looking things back, then I need silence. If it's one where it's more dialogue and I'm kind of letting it flow freely, I really like ambient noise. Mm-hmm. There's a website that I use sometimes called like Ambient Mixer. And what's really cool is they even have these like movie themed ones. And so they have all these Lord of the Rings themed ambient noises. And so I can pretend I'm like at the shores of Valinor or something like that as I'm writing these scenes. And it just is a really good way of sort of getting in that fantastical mindset.
That's perfect. Kwame?
I have three versions. Lightning round. It's either going to be trap music, Star Wars soundtracks, or if I'm writing a sad scene where I need to work up some tears, the second season of Stranger Things, the music to the funeral scene.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's you right here.
It does. Yoel?
I'm like Lisa. I like to turn on YouTube. And I listen to this specific channel. It's Cafe Jazz. And it has this great music that I used to actually use it also when I was studying. I went to law school. And there's something about it when I put it on, I just go in a trance and nothing else gets my attention. And I can write for hours like that. So, but other than that, also silence. That's also good.
That channel out. Thank you.
Yeah.
Phoebe?
So for me, I like to put the noise canceling headphones on. I had to have complete silence because I'm really easily distracted. Yeah, I had to have those on at all times. I mean, this is the smallest thing, and I'm like, you know, and I lost my train of thought. So
squirrel.
Even when I was talking, I lost my thought easy. So you can imagine I'm trying to write. So I have to have a complete total silence. Which is probably weird, but yeah, no, I don't know.
Okay. I think we have time for like two or three more. And these are getting a little bit longer. So it's like kind of lightning extended. So if you could recommend one other middle grade fantasy novel, either something you're loving that's out now or from a few years ago or from your childhood, that people just definitely shouldn't miss. Lisa, sorry to keep putting you on the spot. Here, I'll go in reverse order. Okay, Bibi, I'm going to make you go first on this one.
Yeah. Oh, man. See, now it's funny you say that because I would have said Kwame, I say Tristan Strong at almost every interview. And it's funny because one of the first books when I first started trying to do middle grade, I used to read the, Shannon's book. I couldn't get it out for some reason, but yeah, I read Shannon's book. And so I guess I have to think of something that's not those books.
No, you feel free to say those.
That's good, yeah.
Yeah, those books. Those are definitely. Right.
Keeper of the Lost Cities, everyone.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. Yoel?
So at a risk of repeating what Bibi said, I was definitely going to say Tristan Strong series. Shout out to Kwame. but I guess I'll just say a couple others that are on my mind. By Tomi Adeyemi, The Children of Blood and Bone, and then the second one, that's really great. I guess one that I'm really into now that I'm reading is The Way of Kings by Brandon Sanderson. So I don't know if they all fit in middle grade. So I just gave
them. No. The Way of Kings literally does not fit into all of middle grade.
Yeah, and that's how you see how new I am to the genre. But
1700 pages.
But Tristan Strong, number one.
Yeah. Kwame?
I am going to pick Force of Fire by Sayantani Dasgupta, which is not out yet, and I am absolutely... Oh, May 18th. Look at that. May 18th, it comes out. Force of Fire by Sayantani Dasgupta.
I'm jealous. I want that one. I've heard that's really good.
So good.
just rub it in our faces that you have an early copy, whatever, Kwame.
Y'all have movie deals. I have Force of Fire.
Then?
Oh, me?
Yes.
Oh, Arusha. I love that series by Roshni Chokshi. It's just hilarious and so much heart and just so much fun. So that's my go-to rec, and I'm really glad that nobody took it yet.
And Lisa.
And I'm going to go with Sayantani Dasgupta as well for the Princess Kiranmala trilogy, isn't it? Fantastic. I loved it. It's funny. It's fun. It's really light. And sometimes you just need something funny and light and fun. And that is it.
Sayantani invented a word in the first Kiranmala book, wickety wockety. And ever since I read that, I was like, I want to write like her. She invented a word and I know exactly what it meant. She's like, everything went all wickety wockety. And I was like, I know that feeling. So Sayantani is an excellent author. Read all her books, all of them.
All right, last question. I'd like to know what each of you are working on now, whatever your current projects are, and I'll go randomly this time, so I won't pick on anybody. Let's start with Yoel.
Well, I will give away, Kwame, that me and you are still working on more adventures for Yared, Besa, and the Ibis. So look forward to Untitled number 2, Last Gate of the Emperor sequel.
Awesome. Okay, Kwame, do you want to follow up on that?
Yes, since he stole my answer. Tristan Strong 3 literally just went to copy edits. It's, I'm mostly done with it. It'll come out in this October. And it's not, book 9 or 8.5, and it's not book 300 like Lisa has. But it's the end of Tristan Strong and his adventures with Gum Baby. So it was a little emotional sending that off.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Lisa?
So I am trying something new, a little bit different. I'm doing a standalone. It comes out this fall. It's called Clarice the Brave. And basically, the things I loved reading as a kid, I loved reading like books that happened on ships. And I loved animal stories where the animal has to like overcome amazing odds, like The Incredible Journey or Watership Down. And then I kind of combined my love for the animal on the journey with my love for the sea. And Clarice is a mouse, and she and her brother Charles Sebastian get separated in a mutiny, and they vow to find each other again. And it's a standalone coming out in, I think, October. And then after that, I'll start a new series, which the first book is, we're just about getting to copy edits on that. And I can't even tell you what the title is yet, but we just decided on one, so that's exciting. But that is back to a fantasy series. It's about kids who have supernatural abilities, whose parents have all disappeared, and they're out to find them in a world like we live in, but they've never been to before because they've grown up on this island. I need to get my pitch better for this one.
No, I got it. I got it. I'm sold. I'm sold. Both the mouse and the fantasy island. I'm ready for it.
Yeah.
You know what? That mouse book will make you cry a little bit, I think.
That mouse book, and this is probably going to age me, but it totally has me thinking of An American Tale. And now I've got like Fievel singing somewhere out there in my head. And it's just... Like,
oh, there are no cats in America.
Yeah. I mean, I've never actually seen American Tale, but somebody else said that once too. I think it was really popular, like right around the time I was having kids. And so it just was one of those things that never.
You have to, but just like make sure you have an entire box of Kleenex.
Yeah, please. It's definitely one of those.
Come without about it.
Perfect. All right, BB?
So for me, it's Amari 2, more supernatural fun stuff. Her going back to the Bureau, another summer camp year. And then I also have, doing something with Kwame, a short story anthology called Black Boy Joy that I'm really excited about, come out later this year. And so, yeah, that's what I'm working on.
All right, and let's bring it home with Shannon.
Well, it'll probably surprise no one that I'm working on book 9 of the series that seems to never end and the book that never ends. So it still doesn't have a title I can share or anything else that I can share with you other than I promise I really am writing as fast as I can. And I promise that it's going to start answering some of those questions that I've been getting since book 1. So it's exciting and challenging, you know, trying to sort of start wrapping up all these threads that I have been weaving for this many books. It's like, okay, let's hope my plan works. My evil plan that I've been weaving. Like, I'm so jealous, Lisa, that you've like done it and you've seen like, it worked. It came together. Cause man, these huge arcs, it's kind of like building a bridge while crossing it. And you're just like, man, I hope that my blueprints actually work and I don't end up like, you know, face down in the bottom of the ocean. So we'll see. It's sink or swim time.
You're gonna be fine. You got this.
We are here for it. Okay, I think that's it. So, hey, I just want to say thank you so much to each of you for being here with us. Do you guys want to say goodbye real quick to everybody who attended?
Bye.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
And then I'm just going to go ahead and tell you again to be sure to follow the hashtag. It's hashtag NTTBFest. Attend all the other panels that you can because they are all going to be just as amazing. And be sure to check out bookshop.org for the NTTBF storefront so you can purchase all of these wonderful books that you just heard about today. Okay, I think it's our time to say goodbye. Bye, everybody.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.